It's Tom Green Live. Live from Los Angeles. Tonight's special guest, Steve Carell.
Welcome to the show. This is going to be a fun show tonight, isn't it? This is going to be a great show tonight. We have Steve Carell here for our season premiere on Access TV. How exciting is this? You know, it doesn't get any bigger than that. We've been on a hiatus. We want to welcome you all back to the show. We are going to have a great season. We've got a lot of great guests coming up in the next few weeks, next many weeks. And let's have some laughs together. We're going to be taking more Skype calls this season, so you can call and talk to our guests. And we're going to be taking a lot of Skype calls tonight with Steve Carell. Before we bring out Steve, though, let's go out onto the streets of Los Angeles. Because I want to remind everybody, you know, we're broadcasting here live from Los Angeles. We're really doing that. I think that's kind of cool. You know, I mean, I'm from Canada, man. I look around Los Angeles sometimes, I think, wow, I can't believe I live here in Los Angeles. You know, I grew up in Canada, it was freezing, you go outside, it's freezing. And now it's a beautiful sunny day today, you know. In Canada, you go outside, it's so cold, you feel physical pain. You know? Here in Los Angeles, when you go outside, you just feel emotional pain. That joke worked, right? That joke worked. Yeah, so listen, we're going to go outside every week and go look at some fun stuff. I wanted to go up to the Hollywood sign with you guys, take our camera up there and have a look at it up close and personal. So let's take you out to this cool location. Let's have a look at this. Here we are entering from above. That's what she said. This is Diana Wright from the Hollywood Sign Foundation, and we're rappelling down to the Hollywood sign on a rope. Have a look at this amazing American landmark. It was built in 1923. Let's see what Diana has to say about it. Okay, we've hiked up to the Hollywood sign with Diana Wright from the Hollywood sign.
Yeah, the Hollywood sign trust.
You look after the Hollywood sign.
Yeah, I take care of it. I'm its people.
What exactly do you need to do to look after the Hollywood sign?
We make sure it is protected and that no one vandalizes it, that it gets maintained. We give it fresh coats of paint, and we also license it to be shown in film and TV.
So you're not allowed to just walk up here?
No, it's closed access to the public. The closest you can get is up and behind the sign.
Can we go touch it?
Yeah, we can go touch it.
Can we go touch it and get really close to it so everyone can see how big it really is?
You can kiss it if you'd like.
Wow. Okay, we're going to go kiss it and touch it.
Yeah. See, we're taking you up close. You didn't know it was made out of corrugated aluminum, I bet. I'm taking you up close and having a nice look. There's a plant there. See, these are the things you can't see from the Sunset Strip, you know? We removed the plant. We wanted to make it, you know, but it's, you know, the original letters were actually 20 feet taller. It used to be lit by 4,000 lights. Now there's no lights on it anymore. I climbed up on it. Actually, there was an actress in the 30s who jumped off of this because she couldn't get a job. She committed suicide, Peg Entwistle, jumped off of the H to her death. Personally, I would have jumped off. She should have jumped off the D, I think, because D is for death. No? I don't know. But I just think that would have been more symbolic. Anyway, we're going to have a lot of fun this season. Let's go one more place. I want to show you one more place. I've wanted to play with these drones because you see everyone's talking about these drones. Well, we met up with these guys called the Drone Dudes, and we went to play with their drone to buzz the Capitol Records building, one of the great Los Angeles landmarks.
Come here. Wow. That's pretty cool.
Thank you. How's it going?
Good. How you doing? This is Jeff, Andrew, and Eric. They're the Drone Dudes. And this is cool. Thanks for meeting us today.
Yeah, it's great to be here.
So we're standing here right below the Capitol Records building, and we got a drone with a camera on it. What kind of camera is on that?
So we've got a GoPro Hero on here. It's a really awesome action cam. Great quality, and we've done a few modifications. We've changed the lens out and added an ND filter, so it's ready for, you know, really high-end production.
Okay, so now we're going to take this drone up, And we're going to show you some aerial shots. A shot like this 10 years ago would have cost $1 million. You'd have to use a helicopter to get this shot. But here we are up close and personal of this amazing piece of Hollywood. This was actually the first circular office tower in America. It was one of the first buildings in America that was made to be earthquake resistant, which is ironic because it also gets destroyed by earthquakes in every disaster movie. But there's a light on the top of the Capitol Records building that blinks in Morse code and spells out the word Hollywood. That's pretty cool.
It's just fun to be able to go out and capture shots like this with such a small little tool, and just a lot of fun.
I mean, small little tool, huh? That's what she said.
10 years ago.
We've got Steve Carell on. That's what she said from the office. Steve Carell's going to be here. It's going to be awesome. But no, it's just, you know, it's a lot of fun living in this iconic city, you know. And we're going to take this drone out. Hopefully the drone dudes will take us out again. I want to thank the drone dudes. I want to thank the Capitol Records building. Look, there's a shot of us from the sky. And we're going to take these drones. I wish I'd known about the drone dudes, though, before I'd gone climbing up to the Hollywood sign. You know, maybe our staff could have, you know, done a little more research before they sent me up to rappel down a mountain on a frayed piece of string. I got that joke out all right, huh? Yeah. Rappelled down a mountain on a frayed piece of string. That is wild stuff. No? No, okay. Listen, we're couldn't be happier to be back. We've had a short hiatus. It's been hard for me and all of us to go without being here on the show and talking to you, but we've been working here. We built a new set. You can see we've got a burgundy carpet here in honor of Steve Carell, who is in the great Ron Burgundy Anchorman movie. And we're going to have an excellent, excellent show today. So let's just sit back and relax and get on your Skype and dial us up and talk to Steve Carell. But it's hot in Los Angeles, right?
It gets that way,
yeah. It gets hot here mm-hmm. in the valley.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. No, we're back with Steve Carell is here. Thank you, Steve, for coming to the show.
Absolutely. My pleasure.
We've pumped the air conditioning up, so it's going to get cooler in here now.
It feels good. I like it.
You're used to working around cool temperatures, right? I played hockey my whole life.
What position did you
play? I played left wing.
I played goalie growing up.
Yeah, I grew up. I know you played goalie. Now, what? That's pretty cool because I don't meet many people that played hockey in Los Angeles.
Well, I grew up in Massachusetts. Yeah. So there, East Coast, it was a big... The Bruins in 72, that started a big, big surge of hockey playing. So it was kind of like soccer is in Los Angeles. Every kid played hockey.
Yeah, really? It was
common. I think it was a lot like your experience in Canada. It was just what you did.
Yeah, I mean, the original six teams, Boston was always one of the big teams.
Yeah.
And so why did you decide to play goalie, though? That's what I always wonder.
It was the highest pressure position. I thought that it was the last line of defense. It was, I don't know, I just thought there was something kind of cool about it. Something a little bit different. It was like a different skill set than the rest of the team.
It's like when you let a goal in, everybody's looking at you.
Right.
Everybody's watching you fail.
There's something sort of masochistic about it, I think, because you take it on yourself. Like, I will be the GOAT.
Yeah.
If we lose, it's because of me. So it's like that self-loathing aspect of my personality, I think. Seriously, I think that was part of it. It was like I wanted to take on that responsibility.
Really? Really? Yeah. So you really think that's something to do with
no. Nothing to do with
how do you stop a puck?
Have you been watching the finals?
Yeah.
A quick will stop. I mean, both the goalies will stop puck any means possible.
Yeah.
I mean, and a lot of it's luck. A lot of it's anticipation. You know, definitely it's seeing the ice, seeing the puck. But a lot of times these guys are screened. They can't see a thing. And it's the anticipation or studying, like how a player is lifting his stick, you know, what angle they're approaching the puck, the kind of You know, a lot of it, I think, is just physics, really.
So you're not watching the puck, you're watching the players?
You're watching the sort of the whole thing. You're watching the puck, the players. You're trying to, in your peripheral vision, you're trying to watch what the rest of, I mean, like everybody on the ice, you're trying to get a full, you know, view of everything that's going on in case there's a centering pass, in case there's going to be a tip, you know, all of that stuff.
We've got some pictures of you from when you were your hockey years.
Oh, I bet this is hot.
Did you, I think we have some pictures of you. Yeah, there we are. There you are.
Mm-hmm.
What were you playing in college there? Or?
No, that was high school.
That was high school.
Yeah.
Okay. And has the equipment changed?
Drastically.
Yeah.
Yeah. I wore really big, heavy leather pads. Yeah. And now they're all sorts of, you know, lightweight. They're the style of playing goalie has changed a lot, too. It's all butterfly now. As opposed to, you know, kick saves with the skates and stand up. Like when I first started, they told goalies not to go down at all.
Uh-huh.
You're always.
That's what she said. Then wait, I've been waiting for that.
Yeah. I'll try to sit you up as many times as I can.
Cool. Well, we're gonna have a lot of fun tonight. We're gonna take some calls
okay.
on Skype. We actually have a caller on Skype.
Oh, okay.
You see, when you said that they tell the goalie not to go down, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I did that was an appropriate use of that's what she said.
That
right?
was perfect.
Yeah.
Yes.
That was perfect use.
That was exactly as you should. I've never actually done one of those jokes myself.
Really?
Yeah. In my private life, I allow others to revel in those jokes, but I've never actually pulled the trigger on one.
Okay, let's take a quick question before our first commercial. Hey, you're on the air, Walter in Georgia.
Hey, how we doing?
Very good. Is that Walter there on the air?
Yeah, that's me right here.
Oh, that's Walter. How are you, Walter? What's going on? You have a question for Steve.
I do, yes, sir, Seth. Kind of piggybacking off what you just said regarding your that's what she said moment. Steve, I know you just said that you've never really allowed yourself to use that in real life context. Is there one that you remember vividly that would have been a perfect opportunity for you to use it, you think, at some point?
There are perfect opportunities every day. And part of the problem is I have two little kids, and
right.
I don't want my 10 and 13 year old to start down that road quite yet. So they always are presenting themselves. And sometimes I'll just look at my wife, and we have a specific look that we give each other when the opportunity is there, but we don't say it. It's just like, meh, you know. There's one, and we know.
What's the
know
code? That's the code for it?
Yeah, it's kind of like, meh. Yep, right there, could have done it.
Okay, cool, thanks for your call.
Thanks.
Do we have time for another call? Tom in Minnesota. Tom in Minnesota, you're on the air.
Hey guys, how you doing?
What? Okay, good, we're good. What is that, Tom? What are you doing there, Tom?
These are teeth I'm working on. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
How do you think? What do you think, Steve? Do you like that?
I love those, Tom.
Thank you.
Tom is what are you? What are you, Tom?
A dental technician.
A dental technician, yeah.
Who are those teeth for?
Those are for, well, that would violate the HIPAA, Health Information Privacy Act.
Well,
so I can't say the
name. Just do it. Just do it. Just say it.
Donna.
Oh, okay.
I wasn't actually serious.
Okay, do you have a question there, Tom?
Yes, Steve, I remember you when you started out on The Daily Show with Stephen Colbert, and you did a bit called Even Stevens. I was hoping that you were going to go on when Steve takes over the Letterman show. Could you reprise that skit on the Letterman, on the new Stephen Colbert show?
If he invites me to do it, yeah, I'd love to. I went to his current, the Colbert Report, and we did it on that show once.
Oh, I missed that. That always made me laugh, you guys doing Even Stevens. I think that's kind of where you started out, didn't you?
No, actually, I've known Steven since 1987.
Okay.
We knew each other at Second City. We were in companies at Second City, and then we worked on the Dana Carvey show together. And then he actually got me the job on The Daily Show.
That was a funny bit.
He's a good friend. We've been friends for a long time. Thanks.
Is that just amazing to you to think that, you know, you guys started out together, you were so young together, and now you guys have achieved this monumental success? I mean,
well, I talked to him after all of this last thing happened. Actually, we texted each other, and what I was thinking is this if he does it right, this is the last job he'll ever have. This is what he will be known for. Yeah. And it's so huge. And he's entered this enormous element of his career, this enormous period of his career. And it is kind of amazing to think that back 20 years ago, we were just two goofballs improvising together.
When you were on The Daily Show, did you ever think that you would maybe want to take that path to be in television? As a talk show host?
I don't think I'm well suited for it. Mm-hmm. I mean, I just don't think I have that kind of muscle to be a host of something, to be a master of ceremonies. I don't think, as is evidenced by interview.
You're just being nice, because you know when you were on The Daily Show, that was hilarious. So when you would go out in the street, I used to do a lot of that stuff myself.
Yeah.
Going out in the street.
It's hard stuff to do.
Yeah. Do you ever get beat up or anything like that?
No, I never was in any jeopardy. Some people got pretty pissed off, for sure. I know Steven ran into some trouble with some skinhead people at one point.
Yeah, yeah.
They were onto him, and he went down. I don't remember exactly where it was, and he got into a little bit of a dicey situation.
Uh-huh.
A few of the correspondents did, but I never did, luckily.
Like when you went to Mechanicville, when the guy he kind of grabbed you. What was that? Was that real, that part?
I don't remember specifically.
It's on YouTube. That's on YouTube. People can watch it on YouTube.
I remember what that was. It was our take on Everyone Has a Story.
Yeah.
And we'd throw a dart at a map, and wherever the dart landed, we'd go there and try to find a story.
Yeah.
And there was no story in Mechanicville. And so we just invented everything. I don't remember being in danger.
Yeah.
Someone might have just... Oh, I remember. Yeah,
you were drinking shots with the guy, and he came up and put you in a headlock.
Yeah, he was just drunk.
Drunk guy.
He was drunk. He wasn't really trying to hurt me. He was just roughhousing.
Yeah, cool. Okay, well, we'll be back after this commercial break.
I sued him.
You sued him?
I sued him.
Back with Steve Carell right after this. Stick around. Okay. And we're back with Steve Carell. Thanks, Steve.
Thank you.
This is fun.
I'm having fun.
Yeah.
I'm having fun.
Yeah, I'm having fun.
Are you having fun?
Yes, I'm having fun. I have a fife.
Do you have a fife?
I have a fife.
No.
Yeah.
Really?
I don't know if it's like a bad fife or a good fife, but I have a fife. Yeah.
Oh,
I have two fife. I have two fife. That's still in the wrapper.
Okay.
Yeah. But I've never played the fife before. I left it in the wrapper so that like you knew that nobody else would. Nice. See, I tried all night to do that. I can't do
that.
That's what I
did
last
night.
You blow.
Now I'm going to set you up for one.
Yeah.
You ready?
Yeah.
All you do, Tom, is blow over the hole.
That's what she said.
You blow, actually.
Do I have to cover? Now, you did Civil War reenactments.
I did Revolutionary War reenactments.
Revolutionary War reenactments.
Yeah. Yeah. It's really different.
Yeah. That's a that's a completely different war.
Yeah. It's so much less geeky. So this would be this one's called the Green Cockade.
Okay. The Green Cockade.
Right?
Yeah? That's amazing.
Come on!
Let me try.
So the key is to actually just sort of blow over that.
Yeah.
And you will get hyperventilated.
Okay, I'm not going to figure it out. I worked on this, actually. This is after I've practiced.
It is, it takes a while.
So what made you decide to start doing Revolutionary War reenactments?
It's the girls. All the girls that you meet. My dad did it, and one of my brothers did it.
Uh-huh.
And I thought, well, that, because we grew up in, I grew up outside of like Concord, Lexington. So I ended up being a history major. So that was really, I was interested in the historical aspect of it first. And then I got to play music and be in a fife and drum corps, and I thought that was kind of cool. I started with the Minutemen, but then I became a British reenactor, which was super, like, hardcore. Like, they were very, very, very authentic. You know, the wool in the uniforms was woven at the same factory to the same dimensions that it had been 200 years previously. I mean, they were serious about it.
Yeah.
So in that aspect, I thought it was kind of cool at the time.
Would you speak with a British accent when you were doing it?
We were not allowed to speak.
You weren't allowed to speak?
No, because you'd be yelled at. So the officers barking out orders, they would yell.
Is this when you started thinking about maybe becoming an actor?
No, the first time I thought about becoming an actor was in second grade. We were doing, like, it wasn't even a class play. It was like a little class exercise. We were talking about the Native Americans and the Pilgrims and the first Thanksgiving. So we did these little sort of in class plays for each other. And I remember being in a canoe and rowing. And it was all mime. So I just started rowing like this, and I changed the oar and I rowed on that side. And I'll never forget it. The teacher, Mr. Blackman, pointed that out and said, oh, did you notice Steve used the oar on both sides so the canoe didn't go in a circle? And it was just sort of, you know, for second grade, it was just like an intuitive thing that I had done. But I remember it being like the very first time that somebody had pointed, like singled me out in that way. And it just, it felt so good. I think that was the first time I had any interest in it whatsoever.
Yeah.
It was kind of fun.
Yeah, did you start acting at school right away, or?
Yeah, I mean, I would do, it was always a hobby. It wasn't anything I thought of doing professionally, but it was something that was always fun to do.
Yeah.
But I wasn't a class clown. I wasn't like a big ham in class. But I liked, you know, I liked playing sports. I like playing the fife. I like being in plays, you know. I was a winner.
Cool. We have a call from Pennsylvania, Julie Ann. Julie Ann, how are you? You're on the air with Steve Carell.
Hi, Tom. Hi, Steve. How are you guys?
Well, how are you?
I'm good, thanks. So I was wondering if there's a comedian or comedic actor you look up to, and if so, who is it?
Besides Tom Green, I would say...
Nice.
I'm a big Steve Martin fan. I grew up listening to him and George Carlin. Like, in terms of stand-ups, you know, those guys were very influential, and National Lampoon and Firesign Theater, those are, because I listened to a lot of albums when I was a kid. In terms of, like, actors specifically, I'm a big fan of, you disappeared. you know, people like Jack Lemmon were a big influence to me, and...
So something you remember, the first thing you saw that you just started laughing, you couldn't believe what you were watching?
I remember watching A Funny Thing Happened on the Way to the Forum. Did you ever see that movie? It's a musical. And I remember seeing it as a kid, and it was kind of bawdy for a kid. And I just remember it being joyful. It was Zira Mostel and, you know, a bunch of like great character actors, comedic character actors. I was young, and it just seemed like so much fun. It seemed like everyone in the cast was having a ball.
We have a clip of one of your early performances here.
Oh my God!
Let's run this. This is from Brown's Chicken.
Oh no!
Your Brown's
Big
Chicken commercial.
Brown's
oh,
chicken.
We can't see it in the.
Well,
thing.
We've always cooked our chicken in cholesterol-free cottonseed oil. We now have cholesterol-free batter too, so our chicken is cooked completely cholesterol-free. And it tastes just as great as always. We figured a lot of people would like our new healthier way of cooking, but quite frankly, the response has been better than we'd anticipated. Brown's Chicken, it tastes better, and it's better for you.
Interesting side note, I had been stung by a bee.
Uh-huh.
And I was allergic to bees.
Uh-huh.
But it was the first commercial I ever got, so I didn't tell anybody. And I was up on a ladder, and I was sort of getting a little bit woozy, but I wasn't going to say anything because I didn't want to lose the job.
Yeah, yeah. So. That must have been pretty exciting, though, getting that gig with Brown's
Chicken.
It was, yeah.
and they're still running it.
They are?
Yeah.
Really?
They started. I swear, they started running it again. I think a year ago.
There wasn't something in the contract that said if you went on and became the biggest movie star in the world.
I didn't see that little part. No.
Cool. Okay, let's take one last call real quick before we go to commercial. Jake in Alaska.
How's it going, Tom?
Very good. Oh, you're not Jake. This is our Skype system. There's Jake. We're testing the equipment this week. It's a new equipment. You're the world's best boss.
Nicely done. Subtle.
How's it going, Jake? What's going on? You have a question for Steve.
Yes. What are some factors you consider before taking on a role?
That's actually a really good question because I think first and foremost, is it something that might potentially be fun to do? Who would I be working with? Who the director is? What's the script like? You know, it's like all the things you would assume. But I think to me, one of the main parts of it is, will it be fun, and will people actually either enjoy it or get something out of watching it?
Thank you for your question, Jake. And we're going to go to commercial now. And we'll be back right after this with more questions and more Steve Carell. Stick around. Nice. Back with Steve Carell, and thank you for doing this.
Absolutely, my pleasure.
This is really a lot of fun. You know, I had so much fun doing your show, Riot, that you had me come do, and
you were great.
Yeah, it was it was fun improvising.
Mm-hmm.
I haven't done a lot of improvising, like traditional improv like that. You started in Second City television, in Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
What made you decide to move to Chicago and do that?
I had seen Second City when I was in college. I was in an improv group in college, and Second City toured to Ohio State, which was nearby where I went to school. We went to see them, and I thought, that's what I want to do. That's to tour around the country just doing sketches and improv at colleges seemed like the best gig ever.
Yeah.
So, When we graduated, me and two of my friends moved to Chicago and
just went for it.
Basically, yeah. Got an apartment, started an educational theater company.
Uh-huh.
That's how we thought we were going to pay the bills.
Uh-huh.
We did a two-person version of Lion, Witch, and the Wardrobe,
uh-huh,
where we played all the characters. And And within weeks of it, we all decided this was a terrible idea. Like, we did it for a couple of years, but within the same week, without discussing it, at the same part of the show, we all decided we can't do this anymore. It was when we were playing Mr. Beaver.
Uh-huh.
We had, like, funny glasses in the nose and this thing. All the stuff came out of a trunk, and we were doing these very silly Mr. Beaver voice, looking out at these little kids, and I thought, nope, this is going nowhere for me.
No, would you take classes at first, and then you eventually became part of the cast,
yeah,
or?
Yeah, over years. I mean, you take series of classes in different levels, and then you were invited to audition at a certain point. And so there's a lot of pressure, because if you don't get in, chances are you don't get to audition over and over and over. It doesn't really work like that, because there's always a fresh crew of people coming up to audition. So that's how it panned out.
We have a hilarious clip. We have a clip from Chicago.
Oh, wow.
From
I killed a few people.
Well, I never would have guessed that. I don't believe you.
Okay, oh, perfect. They are taping these up all over the neighborhood. I mean, I don't even think that looks that much like me.
Oh, my God!
Yeah. You're afraid. Great. You know, whenever I tell anybody this, it's, oh, you're gonna kill me. You know?
That must have been just so much fun to just to be doing that in front of an audience like that.
And great audiences. Yeah. It was because in Chicago, the audiences were very savvy and very understanding as to what improv is. You know, the very nature of it, it's going to suck a lot of the time. It's just going to be bad. Mm-hmm. And they went along with it, which was great, you know.
So
six
is that,
nights a week.
Was that improv there?
This was based on an improvised scene. Yeah. You know, I had this idea. Amy Sedaris and I actually did that scene originally, and we just came up with the idea of this. You know, it's sort of a pickup scene. It's a meet cute between a serial killer and a pretty girl, yeah. and they fall in love. But it ended up being pretty close to what that was, the first improv.
Well, is there like a number one rule to improv, a main trick that you're supposed to do when improvising?
I guess listening is the most important. At least that's what I always thought.
Yeah.
You know, and not trying to get ahead of yourself or not trying to think of jokes either. I think when people start to think of jokes or gags, they are immediately drawn out of the scene and they're not listening anymore and they're not responding the way a person would be naturally.
Yeah, okay, cool. Let's take a question from, where are you calling from? This is this is Judy, right? This is Judy?
Yes.
Judy.
Yes.
Hi, Judy, how are you?
I'm good, how are you?
Good, good.
Hi, Judy.
And who is your friend?
Hi, Steve.
Yeah. Who's your parrot friend? What's that? Yeah.
This is Rudy.
Yeah.
And she's 22 years old.
Nice.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
And she bites a lot.
Yeah, I have a green-winged macaw myself. So do you have a question for Steve?
Yes, I do.
Okay. All
Steve,
right.
I'm a big fan, my friend.
Oh, thanks.
Big fan. Now, if you could make a sequel to any of the films that you've made, what would it be?
41-year-old whore. You know, because he's consummated and then he just goes crazy. You know, he just becomes a sex addict at a certain point. I don't know. I'd always wanted to do a sequel to Anchorman. Just really selfish reasons for that one, because it was so much fun to do the first one.
Yeah.
But I hadn't really thought of it.
Yeah. What the sequel was amazing for Anchorman.
It was so much. It's a world that I think you either love or you don't. But it was like going to camp with those guys.
That scene at the end, the fight scene at the end. How was that? Just the most insane day shooting that?
I think it was like a week. And every day,
sure.
You know, there's Kanye and there's Tina Fey and there's Amy Poehler and like this conglomeration of people that would just kind of come in and out. We'd shoot their scene. Sacha Baron Cohen is there and Jim Carrey is there and
Will Smith.
Will Smith did a bit. I mean, what I loved about it is that everybody just wanted to get there and be a part of it.
Yeah.
And Liam Neeson.
Yeah.
He did it on the condition that his son was one of his team, because his son was a fan of the first movie, and they could not have been sweeter and more fun, you know, all day. Just like, it was amazing. Liam Neeson was excited to be in this movie. I was just excited to meet somebody like that. But it was, it was cool.
You still get pretty excited when you meet people like that?
Oh, yeah, all the time.
Yeah.
It's still a little bit weird, you know, because you meet people and you think, this isn't like a circle that I, you know, my wife and I exist in. But then generally speaking, they're just people, you know, there's really nothing that separates anybody.
Yeah. Cool. We'll be back. We've got one last break here and we'll be back with Steve Carell. Stick around. We are back, and this is, you know, we went out on the street of here in beautiful downtown Burbank, right? Is that good?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Perfect.
And And we took some questions from some people on the street for you, Steve.
Okay.
Yeah. So they can't hear us because this was yesterday. But let's roll a question for Steve from the street.
My question is, what are you like in person? Are you just as funny as in all your movies and TV shows?
First of all, that's an adorable person.
Yeah.
With an adorable dog.
Yeah.
No, I'm not as funny.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not saying that I'm that funny on camera either, but I tend not to be on. I tend not to, you know, I'm not a laugh riot. I'm not somebody you invite to a party to perk things up.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just saying that.
Is it because you're expending so much of that energy on stage and on the show?
Yeah, I'm just fried by the end of the day, so I've got nothing left. No, I think I'm naturally a little bit shy, so I'm not extremely gregarious.
Uh-huh. So how do you then make that leap to then when the cameras come on, it all changes?
Because it's more of a character.
Because mm-hmm.
You know, that's not who I am. I'm pretty boring, actually.
Yeah. Well, yeah. No, but I mean. What
I am. Oh, really? No, I mean, yeah. I mean, that's basically it. I'm just not on. And you know, my wife thinks I'm funny, but it's not a wacky household.
Your wife is a hilarious lady. Was
she
on
is.
Saturday Night Live.
Yeah.
What do you guys laugh about? What cracks you two up?
Mostly the kids, because they're at ages now that they understand irony and they are really getting good at it. And and sort of the different shadings of what they're doing, that I think is making us laugh more.
So
than
you
I
watch for that when your son makes a joke? Are you thinking, that's a pretty good joke?
It's stunning. Uh-huh. I mean, it's like either one of them will say something and you'll think, did they understand how funny that was? Because 5 years ago, they didn't. They might have just inadvertently said something cute or funny. Now they get it, and they're actually figuring out how to phrase things that are even funnier, and I don't know, they're pretty good.
Do they watch? Is there certain movies they haven't watched yet and certain movies they watch?
Of mine?
Yeah.
Mostly they haven't. They watched the first Anchorman for the first time. Which is weird because my son was one when that came out, so it's like a lot of people grew up with that at this point. And he and his buddy sat down and watched it one night.
Was that just surreal for them to see you?
It was. Yeah. I mean, I think, and I even more so for me to have my son, who really was just a tiny baby at the time, enjoying it and really understanding the humor of it.
Yeah.
So that it was gratifying.
Very cool. Okay, let's take a question. Do we have a Skype call queued up? Tom in North Carolina. Now let's do another question from the street then. Let's do another question from the street.
Hi, Steve. This is Francis and
Eric.
I'm just wondering, how painful was the chest waxing scene from The 40-Year-Old Virgin?
More painful than you can imagine.
That was real.
It was real.
Yeah.
And all of the women on set told me, trim it down. Like, don't you want to just trim it back a little bit? No. I'm a guy. You know, I'm an athlete. I've done. You know, I've gotten hurt. I've broken bones and twisted ankles. It was so excruciating. People, and it was always the women. It was the women who had the frame of reference with the waxing. They were like, take some Advil, do something to prepare yourself for this. And I didn't do anything. And the woman who waxed it was an actress who had put waxing on her resume. But she wasn't, I think she had done like her boyfriend's shoulder. they started applying the wax to my chest and my nipple area. And she was just about to rip it when somebody yelled, stop, stop, you need to put Vaseline on the nipple because you can actually rip the nipple off with the right amount of hot wax.
Which would have been pretty funny.
It would have been hilarious. It would have been a classic. It would have been a classic scene had that happened.
Already classic scene,
yeah.
But.
But it was, and the worst part was when it grew back in. Mm-hmm. It was just a mess. It was like, ingrown
hair.
Are
you saying it's still like that now?
Or? Yeah, I just left it. But, I keep shaving it down.
But was the idea was just, that was the very first take, that was that the first time you'd ever felt that? Or you didn't try it before?
No. We didn't do any testing at all. And it was my, I said to Judd, I think we should do this scene. I think I should really do it because, not so much because it would be funny that I'm doing it, but the three guys standing and watching would be so horrified. You can't act that as well as just experiencing it. So it was legitimate. Romney Malco had to actually, you watch the movie, he has to leave because he's about to throw up.
He leaves in the movie. That was real. He really left.
He really had to go leave the scene because he was getting so grossed out.
And the lines, like Kelly Clarkson, was that?
A few of those things were thrown in. A few of those.
I was wondering where Kelly Clarkson came from.
That was Judd. Judd was just like, yell Kelly Clarkson. Next poll, yell Kelly Clarkson. So I yelled it.
Cool. Okay, this looks great. We have, is this Tom in North Carolina or is this One Direction? What's going
Either
on,
way.
Guys? How are you?
Good. Hello.
Good. You have a question for Steve?
Yeah, Steve, did you have a backup plan if it didn't work out as a performer?
Teaching. I thought I would teach history and maybe coach a sport or two. That was my backup plan. And as far as I'm concerned, it's still in place.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's what I thought I would do. That's what was interesting to me.
Yeah.
And I thought I could make a career and interesting career out of that as well.
Would you ever consider doing something like that later in life, going back and teaching acting or teaching school?
I don't know about acting. I mean, I don't know how great an acting teacher I would be, but I think I'd be more interested in teaching an academic subject.
Very cool. All right. We'll be back. Stick around. Like we have like two computers and we've like attached them together. We're back and they're like kind of like we're building a new system for the Skype system. So
I thought it worked.
Yeah, it worked great.
Worked great.
Yeah, but the system went down. But we won't take another Skype call. We'll just we're back. Steve Carell's here. We're back. We have a clip. I sometimes like to do that too, where I just keep talking when we come back about something weird. You know,
it's very organic.
Yeah, just to kind of make it kind of.
It's very casual.
Yeah, just kind of make it casual.
It's just like a back and forth sort of thing.
Kind of make it like
that. We're talking.
Yeah, We have a clip from Foxcatcher in your film that's coming out this year. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to just look at it real quick because it's a different type of role for you, and then maybe talk about that for a second.
Okay.
And let's have a look at a clip.
Well, I'm a wrestling coach, and I have a deep love, the sport of wrestling. And I wanted to speak with you about your future, about what you hope to achieve. What do you hope to achieve, Mark?
Okay, this is, that's the clip there. This is a very intense performance, intense character.
Well, it's a very dark story. It's based on a true story about John DuPont and the Schultz brothers. And John DuPont was a millionaire living outside of Philadelphia, and he was a big supporter of USA wrestling. And so he started a wrestling facility on his estate. And in that scene, I'm inviting Mark Schultz, who's a world-class wrestler, to come and coach the team at his estate. And it gets very tangled, the relationships between these three men.
Is that a fun thing for you to switch between doing these outrageous comedic characters and then going to a more serious role like this?
Yeah, I don't know if I just challenging, exciting. It's strange to say fun, because I guess I didn't think of it that way, but it was exhilarating. And working with Bennett Miller, who directed this, was an experience unlike anything I'd ever had before. He's he's so precise, and he knows exactly he really has a vision as to, you know, what he wants the movie to be. But at the same time, he's a real partner in terms of getting there. It was a different sort of thing. It was a different kind of set. It was very quiet. It wasn't very jovial. Wasn't a lot of joking around. It was pretty serious. I mean, the subject matter was serious.
Yeah.
And I think we all took it seriously.
Yeah. I have a gift for you.
Oh.
Yeah. And I can't wait to see the movie.
Thanks. Thanks.
Very excited. I do have a gift for you, though.
Oh. The fife? Not.
No,
the,
it's another
fife?
Gift. We got this for you.
Really?
This came from the Marshfield Hills Village Store.
Oh, my gosh.
On Boston's South Shore. This is
this is a very high-end gift.
Yes, yeah. Do you recognize that gift?
I do recognize this gift because this is a store that I own.
Yes.
In Massachusetts. This is, I'll show you a picture of the store. There's a, we have a postcard of the store. That's that camera?
Yeah.
That's the store.
Yeah. Now, what made you decide to buy a general store and start a general store?
You know what? It's going to sound really geeky, but it was sort of preserving that the history of it. It's his 150-year-old store, had been a general store for, they used to sew Civil War uniforms in the attic. It's that kind of place. And it came up for sale, and we spent summers back in that area. Both my wife and I are from Massachusetts, and she grew up right around there. And I just thought, I want to preserve this. I want the penny candy. I want the front porch and kids sitting out eating ice cream in the summertime. And as sort of a communal meeting place, because not that many places like that still exist. Yeah. I remember places like that when I grew up, but none of them are around anymore. So I thought, if I can just grab this one and preserve it, and continue it for this neighborhood of people that, I don't know, people really seem to appreciate it. I love going there in the summertime. It's great. People just
awesome.
Go and eat muffins and hang out.
That's awesome. Hey, Steve, this has been so great to have you here.
Thank you for the gift.
Thank you so much for coming and spending some time with us.
It was a joy.
Thank you.
Thanks, Tom.
Thanks. We've been here.
You're gonna have the muffins on?